Hello, this is Akram Jafar, and I'm going to deal with picture tests and practical anatomy of the thorax. Today, I'm going to deal with the heart, part 3. You may use the video as a revision or as a self-assessment tool. For the purpose of self-assessment, pause the video and spend some time to read the question and come up with the answer. Replay the video to confirm your answer by listening to the comments and explanations. Identify the structures 1, 2, 3, and 4, which one or ones contains cardiac muscle fibers in its substance, and what is the function of structure 4. This is a longitudinal section of the heart showing the right atrium with its thin wall, right ventricle with a thicker wall, and the left ventricle, which is the thickest of the four chambers of the heart. The opening between the right atrium and right ventricle is called the right atrioventricular orifice, and it is guarded by the tricuspid valve. One of its cusps are shown here and is indicated by number 2. The interior of the cavity of the right ventricle shows a series of muscular ridges called the trabeculae carinae, indicated in 1. The edges and the inferior surfaces of the cusps of the tricuspid valve receive attachments of inelastic cords labeled as 3. These are called the cordae tendini. These cordae tendini are attached to one side to the cusp of the atrioventricular valve, the tricuspid valve in this case. To the other side, it is attached to a tip of a papillary muscle. One of the papillary muscles here is marked 4. Papillary muscles project into the cavity of the ventricle from the trabeculae carinae, which are only present in the wall. The trabeculae carinae 1 and the papillary muscles 4, they contain cardiac muscle fibers inside them. So these are two structures that contain cardiac muscle fibers. The other two structures, which are the cordae tendini and the cusps of the valve, they are made of connective tissue covered by endocardium, the inner layer of the heart. They do not contain cardiac muscle fibers, and they are non-contractile. Regarding part C of the question, what is the function of the papillary muscle? The papillary muscles, they contract prior to contraction of the ventricle, and therefore they are going to tighten the cordae tendini and draw the cusps of the atrioventricular valves. They draw them together by the time ventricular contraction begins. This prevents the ventricular blood from passing back into the atrium during ventricular contraction, because the valves are going to close, and at the same time they cannot be everted because they are pulled down by the cordae tendini. The photomicrograph represents which of the circumscribed areas, 1, 2, or 3. The prosection of the heart shows the anterior aspect where the superior vena cava drains into the right atrium. The pulmonary trunk ascends up from the right ventricle, which forms most of the anterior surface of the heart. So 3 is the wall of the right ventricle. 2 is the ascending aorta, which lies behind the pulmonary trunk and ascends upwards and to the left. Now let's examine the photomicrograph and match it with either the vein in 1, elastic artery in 2, or cardiac wall in 3. The bottom of the photomicrograph here shows cardiac muscle fibers. They are striated with centrally located nucleus and the presence of intercalated discs. Thus, it matches with 3, the wall of the right ventricle. Note also that the top of the slide shows simple squamous epithelium, evidenced by the flattened nuclei lying on subendocardial connective tissue, which also shows some Purkinje fibers. These are modified cardiac muscle fibers, which are a little bit larger than the cardiac muscle fibers. They have less striations, and you can see that the cytoplasm contains less organelles. That's why it looks or stains lighter than the cardiac muscle fibers. And these Purkinje fibers, they constitute part of the conducting system of the heart. Which number combination represents the auricular appendages? The auricle in Latin refers to the ear. The specimen on the left shows an anterior view of a plastinated heart, showing mainly the right ventricle and the left ventricle. The labels of the great vessels can be identified as 3, the second branch of the arch of the aorta, the left common carotid artery, 4 is the left subclavian artery, 2 is the ascending aorta, and 5 is the left pulmonary artery, a branch of the pulmonary trunk. The right auricular appendage, 1, overlies the commencement of the aorta, and the right part of the atrioventricular groove, which contains the right coronary artery. The left atrium forms the posterior chamber of the heart, and most of it is not seen in this view, therefore. But its auricular appendage, labeled 6, can be seen on the left border of the heart between the left ventricle and the pulmonary trunk. Note that both auricles, 1 and 6, right auricle and left auricle, they clasp the infundibulum of the right ventricle, the outflow tract of the right ventricle that leads into the pulmonary trunk. The combination, therefore, is 1 and 6. Which of the vessels, A or B, provide a marginal artery, and which of them provide septal branches for the interventricular septum, and which of them is more likely to supply the SA node? First, let's identify the vessels. A lies in the atrioventricular groove or coronary sulcus. It is the right coronary artery. You can see its origin from the ascending aorta here. Toward the inferior margin of the heart, it gives a right marginal artery. Not very clear in this specimen, but it supplies a right marginal artery, which is also called an acute marginal artery, referring to the acute margin between the anterior and inferior surfaces of the heart. B is the anterior interventricular artery and is located in the anterior interventricular groove between the right ventricle and the left ventricle. It supplies septal branches that cannot be seen here because they dip immediately into the interventricular septum. It also supplies small ventricular branches to the right ventricle, which is mainly supplied by the ventricular branches of the right coronary artery, and it supplies diagonal branches to the left ventricle. The left marginal artery, which lies on the left border of the heart, also called the obtuse border, is derived from the circumflex branch of the left coronary artery and not from the anterior interventricular artery, the circumflex branch that passes around the heart. Therefore, it is only A that provides a marginal artery, and this is the right marginal artery. Branches to the interventricular septum, as I mentioned, are derived from the arteries located in the atrioventricular grooves, either anterior interventricular artery, B, or posterior interventricular artery. The posterior interventricular artery is not shown here because it is located on the inferior surface of the heart. In fact, the anterior interventricular artery supplies most of, or about two-thirds, of the interventricular septum with septal branches. So A, by itself, does not provide septal branches. The SA nodal branch, in 60% of the cases, is a branch of the right coronary artery at the beginning of the artery. In 40% of the cases, the SA nodal artery is a branch of the circumflex artery. Therefore, B, which is the anterior interventricular artery, by no means can provide the SA nodal branch. And the SA nodal branch, in this case, can be provided by A only. In which pericardial sinus is the index finger placed? Which vessel lies posterior to the tip of the inserted finger? This is a view of the heart in situ in the middle mediastinum after cutting the pericardium. The pericardial cavity is located between the parietal pericardium, the glistening side of the membrane shown here, and the visceral pericardium, which is directly applied to the heart. Pericardial sinuses are formed as pockets during elongation and bending of the heart tube during embryonic development. One of them is the transverse pericardial sinus. And this sinus can be accessed by placing a finger behind the aorta and pulmonary trunk. The finger slides to the right in front of the superior vena cava. Here's the superior vena cava. You can see how it is formed by the left and right brachiocephalic veins, and the superior vena cava opens into the right atrium. Remember that the pericardial sac not only encloses the heart, but also the root of the great vessels. It is the superior vena cava that lies posterior to the tip of the inserted finger. Which valve combination is responsible for the production of the first heart sound? First, we have to identify the valves. The picture on the left is a longitudinal section of the heart showing the right atrium, right ventricle, and left ventricle with the thickest wall. One represents a cusp of the tricuspid valve. This valve is located at the right atrioventricular orifice between the right atrium and right ventricle, and is also called right atrioventricular valve. This picture here in the center shows a posterior view of the heart and is occupied mainly by the left atrium. Note the pulmonary veins. Here is one pair on this side opening into it, and the other pair should be from the other side. The posterior wall of the left atrium is opened, and we can see inside the left atrium, we can see the mitral valve, or the left atrioventricular valve, or the bicuspid valve that leads into the left ventricle. The third picture, the picture on the right, is a superior view of the heart. The left atrium forms the posterior chamber again. You can see the superior vena cava opening into the right atrium, the pulmonary trunk guarded by the pulmonary valve, a semilunar valve, located anterior to the aortic valve that guards the aortic orifice at the beginning of the ascending aorta. Note the right and left coronary arteries arising from the ascending aorta behind two of the three cusps of the aortic valve. The first heart sound is produced by the closure of the atrioventricular valves, that's to say the tricuspid and the mitral valves. The second heart sound is produced by the closure of the two semilunar valves, the pulmonary and aortic. Identify the space with the shadow A and identify the rounded structure at the tip of the arrow B. This is a view of the heart showing the right ventricle. Note the thickness of the myocardium, it's not an atrium, and is not as thick as the left ventricle. The right ventricle continues with the pulmonary trunk, and here's the pulmonary orifice that is guarded by the pulmonary valve. Even if you cannot figure it out as a pulmonary valve, the shape of the half moon of the three cusps, 1, 2, and 3, indicate that it is a semilunar valve. Whether pulmonary or aortic, the cusps of the pulmonary and aortic valves are similar to each other, but they differ in locations. The free edge of each cusp is thickened, as you can see here, forming the lunule. The apex of the angulated free edge of the cusp contain a central fibrous nodule that is indicated in B. The nodule assists in closing the central areas of the edges of the cusps. The cusps, as you can see here, are cup-shaped, and they bulge down in a convexity. This is a longitudinal section here, showing the cusps projecting into the artery. However, the cusps lie close to the wall of the artery as the blood leaves the right ventricle, and following the relaxation of the ventricle, the elastic wall of the artery will force the blood back toward the heart. So the valves will open like pockets and completely close the pulmonary orifice. This prevents the blood from returning to the right ventricle. Therefore, opposite each cusp, the shaded area in A, the wall of the artery is slightly dilated to form a sinus. A indicates one of the sinuses of the pulmonary valve. The blood in these sinuses prevents the cusps from sticking to the wall of the artery and failing to shut. In the aortic valve, two of these sinuses contain ostia for the coronary arteries. A 45-year-old man sustained a penetrating wound to his chest that resulted in cardiac tamponade. Blood accumulates in which of the following numbered spaces? Cardiac tamponade is a clinical syndrome caused by the accumulation of fluid in the pericardial space. This results in reduced ventricular filling and subsequent hemodynamic compromise. So we have to identify the pericardial cavity in which blood accumulated. One points at the costodiaphragmatic recess of the pleura between the diaphragm and the thoracic wall. Two is the pericardial cavity. Note that it is located between the glistening layer of the parietal serous pericardium and the visceral pericardium that overlies the heart and forms the outer layer of the wall of the heart, the epicardium. The fibrous pericardium is rough and is most external, as you can see it here, but it fuses with the parietal layer, and there is no cavity separating between the fibrous pericardium and the parietal layer of the serous pericardium. 3 is the cavity of the left ventricle. It is not the pericardium. You can see the thickness of the wall. Blood naturally is located there, doesn't accumulate in cardiac tamponade. 4 is the pleural cavity. Please note that this is a plastinated section with a lot of shrinkage. That's why the pleural cavity looks wide. In reality, it is a thin potential space between the visceral pleura covering the lung and the parietal pleura lining the thoracic wall. 5 is pointing to the inside of a section of the arch of the aorta, and it is not the pericardial cavity. So the correct answer here is 2.